I'm Elizabeth Kidd. I'm in the Department of Radiation Oncology. I'm an associate professor, and my specialty is gynecologic radiation oncology. Well, I was interested in, you know, working with cancer patients from early on. And then, you know, so I went to medical school, and in medical school, I actually discovered radiation oncology. I wasn't aware of it earlier, and I really liked the field. I liked the interactions you could have with patients, the, you know, continuity of care. So, you know, while patients are getting treated, we see them once a week, and then with some patients in follow-up, you know, months, years after treatment, and I really like that. And I also liked the technology of radiation oncology, that it's, the field had really advanced a lot, so that we had opportunities to really improve the treatment, both in terms of patient outcomes for disease control and also from side effects. So I really liked the field. And then when I did my residency in radiation oncology, so we actually learned how to treat all different types of cancer in residency in radiation oncology, I really was drawn to gynecologic radiation oncology. I really liked the procedural nature of gynecologic radiation oncology. It's kind of different than a lot of things we treat. So with gynecologic radiation oncology, I'm treating, you know, cervix tumors or vaginal tumors, which is actually something that, that you can see the tumor within a pelvic exam. And the thing that's nice about that is you can also see the tumor melt away. So we'll examine the patient early on, you know, at the time of consult, before we start the treatment, and you can see the tumor. And then as the treatment goes on, usually a few weeks in, the patient's noticing improvement in their symptoms. And then as we plan for their internal treatment or brachytherapy, we'll often examine the patient again, and we'll see a dramatic change in how the tumor looks from, you know, before they started treatment to, you know, a few weeks in, that we're seeing the change. And then as I'm doing the internal treatments or brachytherapy, again, I continue to see the tumor melt away. And in other parts of radiation oncology, it's usually that we do the treatment and then we get imaging a few months later and see how the tumor has responded, which is also satisfying. But with gynecologic cancers, it's nice that you can just kind of, you know, see the tumor melt away as you're doing the treatment, which is really satisfying. Yeah, well, so usually, you know, oftentimes the patients will present with, you know, pain or bleeding or some sort of symptom. And those symptoms actually tend to improve pretty quickly in a week or two. So patients often kind of have a, you know, good, you know, already kind of a good sense of things that, you know, some of their symptoms are improving. At the same time, you know, they always, you know, as you're going through treatment, it, you know, it can be tiring and that sort of thing. So it's nice to have other encouraging, you know, words. And so, you know, when we, you know, when I do a repeat exam, you know, as they're doing, going through the treatment, if I'm seeing the tumor shrinking, it's also, you know, kind of really encouraging to the patient that, you know, all the efforts that they're putting in are, it's worth it. There's probably been a lot of different things. I guess some of the things that have surprised me is how we can continuously get better. You know, we, certain things that we thought, you know, this is kind of as good as we can do, you know, 10 years ago, we can improve upon that. As you know, I think one of the things that kind of exemplifies that is how we can treat more advanced disease with sort of a curative intent now than we could several years ago. You know, we used to think that certain stages of disease, or if the disease had sort of spread from the primary site, our likeliness of curing it was, you know, not that good. But, you know, I see patients that we, you know, have done, you know, just that. You know, recently I saw a patient in follow-up who I actually treated, I guess she finished treatment about 3.5 years ago. So she hasn't had any either radiation, chemo, any type of treatment for the past 3.5 years. When I first saw her, actually about 4.5 years ago when she first presented, she had pretty advanced disease. And, you know, both the patient and myself and her other team members were worried about how she was going to do. And she did very well with the treatment, but at the same time, because of how advanced her disease was, we, of course, were worried that she's going to develop other types of disease, which did prove to be the case. But then we selectively targeted those types of disease with radiation, and they've remained controlled, and she hasn't developed new sites of disease. And so it's really nice when you can see that, you know, you can treat patients with fairly advanced disease and have at the same time, it is one of the things, you know, we've done a great job of curing her, you know, control of her disease, but she does have side effects from the treatment. So as we continue to get better, you know, we focus on improving the control of the disease, but also decreasing the side effects from our treatment. I guess a couple things. One thing, so one of the things that I do for treating the gynecologic cancer is putting needles into the area of the tumor. So either we're putting needles into the area of the cervix or into a vaginal tumor, and that those needles or catheters allow us to deliver radiation to that area. So a lot of other types of radiation comes from the outside in, but with internal radiation or brachytherapy, you put some sort of applicator or needle in the area of the tumor or close to the tumor, and then the radiation emanates outward from that. So gynecologic cancers sort of lend themselves well to that because of the anatomy there. But it can be challenging to place the needles exactly where you want. So one of the things that I've been working on, both to help improve treatments for gynecologic patients treated at Stanford and other places, are tools to help make gynecologic brachytherapy more accessible, both in terms of for patients and for practitioners or physicians doing those types of treatments. So one of the things that I've been working on is developing small templates that can help guide the needles. And so these are 3D printed, and we can kind of individualize them based on the patient's anatomy, both their, you know, their like vaginal anatomy, as well as the tumor anatomy, so where the needles need to go to cover the tumor. And so we've been 3D printing these, and so we order them from a company because, you know, when you're using a 3D printed item in patients, you know, it needs to be a biocompatible material and it needs to be sterilizable. And so the process works, but ordering them from a company, the time from getting imaging to getting the usable template is a bit more than a week because you design it, you order from the company, they make it, they send it, we have to do a few tests on it, we sterilize it, and then we can use it. So it takes like a little bit more than a week. But if we are actually able to have our own 3D printer that can print this type of biologically compatible material that can be sterilized, it would be a much quicker process, probably on the order of 2 to 3 days, in the sense that we could design it. And then generally they can be printed overnight. We do the test on it, then it would be sterilized, and then you could use it the next day for the procedure, which would be nice to have that kind of quicker turnaround between, you know, when you get the imaging and when you get the template to help the procedure. Yeah, I do a lot of reading in my downtime. You know, it's kind of a nice escape. I probably do a lot of reading relating to cancer. One book that I recently read that I enjoyed was called Happiness, a Memoir, The Crooked Little Road to Semi-Ever After. And it's actually not about a cancer patient, but it's about a mother dealing with a sick child and kind of her journey in the healthcare system. And I could relate both as a mother and also, you know, the challenges people go through in dealing with the healthcare system, you know, the challenges of, you know, you're already dealing with, you know, some difficult diagnosis and, you know, either a sick family member or yourself being sick. And then you have to deal with the challenges of, you know, just accessing, who do you need to see? How do I get the different tests? How do I pay for this? And so I found that, you know, I could really relate to the things that she was going through from having, you know, seen it from the physician's side. And then at the same time, you know, you could see, you know, how things turned out. And as sort of from the title, happiness, you know, it was a difficult journey, but, the process went out well. So. Looking at ways to decrease bone marrow related toxicity from the combination of radiation and chemotherapy. So commonly, either for cervix patients or for uterine cancer patients, the patients will often get treated with a combination of both chemotherapy and radiation, generally to the pelvis. And so both those things, the chemotherapy and radiation to the pelvis, can cause a decrease in your blood count. Chemo tends to have a little bit more of an effect, but the effect from radiation relates to the fact that your blood cells are actually made in your bones, and some of the main bones that are involved in that are in the pelvis, so kind of like the hip bones, the femurs, kind of the bones of your upper leg or the spine. And so what we've been looking at is ways that we can help decrease the risk of falling in blood counts. Because when the blood counts decrease, in particular like the white count or the platelets, but the white count's kind of the most common, when the counts go down, frequently the patients need to hold or stop chemotherapy. And studies have shown that the more chemotherapy patients can receive, or the prescribed dose or the planned treatment, the better patients do. But at the same time, you have to, do the treatment safely. So if the counts won't allow patients to receive the chemotherapy, we need to hold the chemotherapy. But if there's ways that we can improve the treatment so that patients are able to get through more of the chemotherapy, we likely can improve the outcome. So the way this study works is that you can give an agent that sort of stimulates the bones prior to the patient's having their planning scan, or to kind of stimulate the bones so that when we do their planning scan for radiation, we can see what areas of the bone should we spare more. Where are these precursor cells? And so then when we're doing our planning, we can better spare these important areas of the bone, and then likely the patients will have less decrease in their blood counts and then be able to receive more of their chemotherapy and then hopefully have a better outcome from their treatment. Well, there's kind of a few reasons why I came to Stanford. I actually grew up in the area. I grew up in San Mateo. So when I was looking for a job, I was hoping to come back to the Bay Area, and I was also looking for a position where I could do gynecologic radiation oncology. And so I was lucky enough to find both of those in Stanford, and I knew Stanford would be a great place to work, and I have found that to be the case as well. I think some of the strengths about Stanford is how strong you have, how strong the departments are in different areas. So that, if you want to collaborate with somebody in pathology, they're very good. If you want to do some lab work, you can find collaborators. And I found that to be the case, that, oftentimes you'll have an interest on something and you can find somebody to work with who's like an expert in the field. And so that's been really great.